So, this buff is about handling of the home directory and of configuration files in the home directory, and it's basically a fastest hierarchy standard concept for the home directory. There were some other talking during this discussion about making it also about APIs for configuration files, so that there will be a library that can handle multiple types of configuration files and convert between them with administrators preferable. But it doesn't quite fit the specification we're working for, and so that would have to be a separate project there. So I'll start with the problems, and I'll show you what the current specification is at the freedesk.org, and the ideas that I have gathered from people for the next version of this specification and how to implement them. Then we can discuss that or think about something completely different maybe. So the initial problems were, first of all, the file system hierarchy standard does not regulate at all how applications handle the data inside a home directory. It's just isn't there. Then the other problem that is more closer to me as a developer of a backup program is that backup applications cannot differentiate between different types of data that are stored in the user directory. There is user's content, there is configuration data, there is temporary data that, well, should not really be backup.
I have a question here. What's, from the point of view of a backup application, the difference between user content and user configuration?
I'll try to differentiate that a bit later on. So, for example, if a photo and a tags for a photo are user content, then
because it's hard to me to see why do you have to differentiate? You have to back up and restore it anyway.
For example, the list of the game, the configuration for the game, for the chat, its configuration.
Okay. The slightly different example was, for example, for an email program, there is the configuration of how you read your email, how you maybe receive your email, and the email itself. The point of restoring it separately is that you could have an email program that stopped working with the latest configuration information, but you still need the emails that you have received before. So you would restore the emails, but not the configuration of the program.
And you can have different backup policies for each other. The emails change very much, and the configurations tends to be stable. So
okay, yeah, that's another point there.
I think that's a very hard point, a hard task. But I see your intent. Yes.
Another application of this, if we separate the configuration from everything else, is a uniform way to reset the configuration of an application, so that we know that here is, in this folder, is every thing that is configuration for this application, and if we erase that folder, we only erase the configuration, reset it to default, and no user data should be lost that way. And there's currently a load of files in the user home directory, and all of them are hidden. A lot of users even don't know that they are there. It's a hidden complexity for many users there. When I proposed this idea on my blog, people came to me and said, oh, well, there is a free desktop org specification about that, the XDG base directory specification. It's currently at version 0.6 and hasn't changed since 2004. It specifies splitting the data, splitting the user home directory data into data, configuration, and cache information. It has a very detailed and complex information about how there could be multiple directories for user data, multiple directories for user configuration, and in what priorities they all have. And also it had environment variables that allowed administrators to have to have the configuration information or user data.
Hello, welcome.
Outside, outside the
radio.
Okay.
Sorry.
Yeah. And there was nothing about some directories. So there's also only a global definition of, well, the config information of all applications will be here in this directory. And nothing about how applications should share between themselves in there. And there are a couple of implementations of this specification in software as well. When I talk to people that are developing this, they seem to be eager that this specification moved forward somehow to create maybe better versions of it that are more implementable, and then gain a wider implementation of them, because currently developers look at it as a very complex thing to implement. So only a few programs have done that. So what I think about moving on from that specification is I want to see Debian as a leading role in the community in this sense, and by creating and implementing the new version of this specification and moving it on into the wider community. By doing three steps: first, defining what we want here, the specification. Second, the step, implement that via a hack by basically redirecting access from old config files or old data locations to new ones via the LD preload library or something similar, and then push these changes into individual packages further upstream. So what I've thought about so far in this version 1, there need to be three data classes, the configuration data, user data, and temporary data. Use patterns and rules of operation of every class need to be defined. Folders for each class need to be defined. There should be at least a recommendation about how applications should use the subdirectories, how related applications should share these subdirectories. And also we need to clearly define migration path from either the regular situation or from the 0.6 version of this specification. There were two proposals about the main look of the folders. They could be type/application folders or application/type folders. The difference being that in first option there would be one folder which contains configuration for all applications, and the same. One folder containing all cache for other applications or user data for other applications. And the second option would be that configuration, cache, and user data are in one folder for each individual application. And then they are put into some bigger folder there. When the first option is similar to what we have here in the, now in the specification, in the 0.6 version of the spec, and the second option is more similar how the Mac OS X is treated, where every application basically is a folder with a strictly defined contents, where there is a location for the binaries, a certain location for the configuration, a certain location for user data, for application data, and similar. I myself, after long discussion, prefer the second option, actually, because it allows. I haven't seen any drawbacks of the second option so far, but I have been shown some interesting side benefits of choosing this way of storing configuration. I'll get to that just a bit later. So what I see is a configuration data, just settings and parameters of the software. The main thing is that the software should work, should continue to work, but just reset to default settings if the configuration data is removed. So nothing that the user created should be erased or lost if you just erase the configuration data. And there are borderlines here and questions. For example, is the POP3 access information to remote email, is that a configuration thing? Because if you remove it, then you cannot access the user data at a remote location until you configure it again to the action of the application slightly changes here. That should be defined in the specs by example, so the programmers later can refer to that. User data. That's data files that users have created or made significant contributions to creating, and have not explicitly saved to another location. That, for example, would be the emails or the tagging information from photos that isn't saved to the photos themselves, for example. And it should never be necessary to erase the user data to make the software work again. So software should not be breakable by the user data. If software is breakable by something, that is probably configuration. Or should be rephrased. And I think in the specification there's a place for suggestions to application writers as to how to handle different types of data. And for example, that applications should be extremely careful when writing user data to avoid losing it in all situations, including situations like a full partition. And temporary data is the last class that can be regenerated or is of temporary use, like web cache or image thumbnails. There's quite a lot of this information in the home directory. For example, the thumbnail directory can be several hundred megabytes large on a typical user home directory after several months of use. And applications should be prepared that this data can be erased at any point. about the structure of the folder names. So if we go with the section or the second option, the structure like this can be formed, where all the information of the application, the only place where the application can write in the home directory, except special user requests, would be home, some kind of folder name like library, like it is in Mac OS X, and folder for the application name. It would store the configuration data in home library application name config, temporary data in home library application TMP, cache, not quite sure which to use here, maybe better. And they could store the user data in the rest of this folder. It is quite fine with the backup software actually, because at least my backup software can have regular expressions, which makes no difference whether it is cache dot application name or application name dot slash cache. So it should be able to handle such a situation. No additional problem.
The configuration would be shared by many applications?
It is an issue there that needs to be addressed. That there are applications that are sharing information between themselves, and where that information that would need to be stored. So it should probably be defined as some kind of master application that would store this config information.
Or maybe generic names for application name, for example, email or mails or something like this. Mail slash config, and there is the...
Like a virtual application that is holding the generic
information
data.
The problem is that it will be complex and will be hard to manage. And many of these things are in the code, are coded in the code.
Yes.
Many applications, so will be very difficult to address this.
It could be the next step of consolidating similar configuration information from multiple applications. It's partially what gconf is supposed to do.
Right, I was asking, how does this relate to gconf?
Gconf is a very, very problematic case here.
Why?
Because it stores the configuration of an application in a completely unrelated place to that application. So you can't really define a way to reset, for example, the all configuration information of evolution, maybe.
Why not?
Because it is in multiple locations, even inside the gconf.
Can we manage it like?
Sorry, all configuration of evolution is under one specific tree. And you can reset the configuration of evolution with one command line called just reset everything under below this subtree. In fact,
I'm not sure about the evolution. I haven't looked at it. Yes, it could be in one subtree.
Well, if it's spread among several subtrees, we could consider that as a bug or something, or we would need some really good explanation why it's scattering across the. But even then, evolution itself is registering a schema, and you should be able to say, look at all keys which are being registered by the scheme of evolution and reset all keys introduced by the schema evolution has introduced. So in fact, it's quite easy to do this with gconf.
Question of how gconf would fit in. maybe even how whether configuration information from the gconf should somehow be stored into the same directories, or it would really need to be separate. It's an interesting question to have here, and I'm not quite sure of the answer at this moment, because I would really like everything to be in a folder and not spread across multiple locations, even if there is a map of these locations somewhere.
Maybe you are thinking in backup and he's thinking in integration. The point of view are different, I think.
Well, gconf is some sort of configuration database. You don't have to care where the configuration actually is. You have a new configuration space, this gconf tree, and you think, where in the gconf tree is my configuration stored, and you don't care where it is on the file system. In fact, you can even configure it to be an elder.
Yes, but the problem is that I do care where it is in configuration. In the files, when I try to backup it or restore it.
Well, the canonical answer of a gconf developer, which I'm not, would perhaps be, well, you would need to write a backup interface to gconf databases.
Which would be nice. Yes, which would be a pretty bad answer this case, because in that case everything is standardized except gconf, which would be a special example.
Well,
exception.
You can take say the other way around. Gconf introduced a standard, and now the other folks are doing something else. I'm not that fond of gconf anyway, but I understand why they are. I understand their points in some ways. Well, for the beginning, you could, of course, treat the XML file gconf is, well, by default, gconf uses an XML backend for configuration data. And you could treat that XML file as configuration data, for a start.
The solution might be to treat gconf as one single application and integrate this single application into this scheme.
Well, that could be a very, very rude hack to get it working, but
I'm not quite sure if it's really a bad hack.
The point for example is the same evolution. If we later, one of the targets of having this specification made is to have an application that is resetting settings simply by erasing a configuration directory. So to have an account of gconfized programs, like an evolution, it would have to erase evolutions to the config directory and the evolution subdirectory in gconf directory.
Yeah, I just checked it. For the specific case of evolution, we have a tree in the gconf database called apps evolution, and it's quite easy to say, please reset everything below this subtree.
Right.
So
I'm not quite sure if every configuration, every information of evolution is there. It could be that some parts of the configuration are shared with other programs,
for
and
example,
therefore outside the stream. I have no idea. I have not looked into this specific case.
Okay, then to comment. First, I don't think that it is, and if it is, I perhaps consider that as a bug.
Well, it could be a feature, because, for example, several programs share for font information.
For example, the proxy, server.
All the proxy server information, yes.
I'm not sure I
prefer the
integration of
that. Well, is that configuration data of evolution?
Kind of.
No.
It influences the how evolution works.
That's a very vague definition.
Yeah.
I think evolution is a very particular example. It's a very big program and with a lot of concepts there.
Well, we have to consider it.
But maybe it's not the it's not the happy order that we look for. Maybe evolution will be the application which needs more hacks to be integrated to the standard.
Well, anyway, what's the point of, what's the problem we're discussing actually here?
Well, there are two uses of the spec. The backup and restore of everything except cache, basically. Maybe with different types of backup for configuration and for user data. And an application to reset configuration of applications.
Well, I think there isn't actually a problem here, because everything which is stored in gconf is in fact configuration.
Yes.
There is no temporary data in gconf. It doesn't make too much sense to put there temporary data, nor does it make sense to put user data in there.
Right.
So, for the matter of that spec, we could just perhaps treat gconf indeed as an application of its own and make it store its back-end data for the configuration as gconf configuration and be done with it. If you want to reset a specific application, well, then you would need some specific interface which knows which schema or the application has introduced in gconf and say, please reset all configuration data of this application, which then involves resetting gconf tree.
Well, a slightly more cleaner approach like here is to have the gconf store this particular tree of configuration just there in this directory.
Well, of course, you could perhaps write an XDG based your conforming gconf backend. That should be also possible.
Yeah.
So in the sense that you don't store it in one flat XML file, but spread across your library subdirectory, it should be possible as well, but I don't see much point in it, but anyway.
Right. It's just the problem of applications using slightly different short names for themselves, like there's Thunderbird, Mozilla Thunderbird, and, some confusion by the application on there, but that's unrelated to the main problem here.
Right.
The interesting part about having application type directories is that you can have other folders there that are well, okay, these are folders for plugins, maybe. You could have Firefox, for example, store their plugins inside that application name, and maybe share and plugin name with the executable files for some plugins that are executed somehow outside the software itself in the bin subdirectory. And configuration files for the plugins integrated into the configuration for the main software, as well as having a possibility of adding something to the menu by having a desktop file there in the application name directory. The idea behind all of this is to possibly later allow having install applications, user installed applications that are basically that are simply unpacking this application directory into the correct place in a similar way that it is done on Macintosh, the idea is that you receive from the internet an archive, you unpack it into, move it, or unpack it into your library, and you have an installed application. Inside that archive, there's a bin where you have the executable files. There is something that adds this application to your menu. There are program files, config files, every part of that application. And once you, as a user, put it in your library, there is a part of the menu that gets regenerated, and this application gets added to your menu. I think it would not be that hard to add this functionality once these directories are established, so that third-party software can be installed by end users in an extremely simple manner then.
And you are aware that such a directory, like the last point on the slide, already exists, and it is called by default .load to share applications. Are you?
Dot local share applications.
Dot local share applications. If you place in your, if you put some .desktop files in there, for example, the GNOME or KDE desktop will respect that desktop file and, for example, override system-wide or register user-specific application installed in home directories or somewhere.
Well, yeah, that's great.
Oh, you weren't aware before.
Yeah, okay. I was aware that there is such a thing, but I wasn't aware where it is. So.
For example, I can show you, I installed this Adobe Reader, for example, which is a normal desktop file which tells how you start an Adobe Reader.
Right. Okay.
So this already exists and is already used.
Great. Well, as it is part of the home directory, it should be in the specification on where these files should be.
Well, that's the desktop specification of Free Desktop Org.
Right. But it also needs to be here if this specification is to describe everything that applications need to do it
well,
in the home directory.
Obviously, the specification should need to conflict each other.
That's true. That's true. The thing is, with .local applications, it is in a different location than this application directory. So the desktop file would need to be copied over to there. If this can be either changed or added as additional way that desktop files can be added. If we take this Adobe software and you simply unpack its archive into your library directory, then it gets installed without any need to execute any scripts or copy any files around. I think would simplify matters significantly. But, well, yeah, that's a way to add this to the desktop file specs. And the migration path. My suggestion is that we do this in two simple steps. First, we do an ugly hack that uses either LD preload or some other way to hack into the system and intercept every file request and have a map from old file locations to new file locations, so that every file request to old location to actually go to a new correct location in the home directory, possibly with moving the old file over while this process is being done. And the additional benefit of this actually is that if we make this generic preloading library of rewriting file locations, preferably using that allows the use of regular expressions in this, it could be a very useful administrative tool for moving files that don't exist yet, basically. And would allow us to do this migration. And in the second step, we just add that support for this specification is a policy requirement, and in a couple of Debian releases, introduce that to the software and forward that upstream.
Is that your last slide?
Yeah, that is.
Okay, then thank you for your presentation. I have a few remarks about
that.
Let's start with the last one. I'm not too convinced about this migration path. I think the very first step of this plan should be to prove that it actually works. This means to take one application, one well-known application or larger applications,
right,
to actually use this, implement the specification and to show the benefits of that.
Mm-hmm.
So in the first steps, you have you introduce a new allocation, this library directory,
right,
library configuration space, and they show that there are actually benefits of it.
Mm-hmm.
For example, by supporting the new backup application. And then to convince to more and more upstream to actually adopt this this specification. I am the maintainer of the media player Xeen,
right,
and I know that Xeen is actually adopting this base specification for the next release 1.2,
right,
but version 0.6. They don't know about 1.0 because that's, I think, a brainchild of yours, is it?
Yes.
Okay. So there are actually upstreams which are keen on using that.
Mm-hmm.
And before we are doing ugly hacks like this, I'd rather try to convince main adopters of large applications like KDE, GNOME, XFCE, to actually adopt it before we try to migrate legacy applications.
Mm-hmm.
And the next thing is, this is not how Debian policy works. You don't change policy in order to change things in Debian. No, you change things in Debian first and then adjust policy according to what's actually done. This is what I'm observing regarding the later changes in policy. Because this way is pushing changes in Debian policy first is going to that lots of Debian maintainers will scream and not implement the policy, and then you get terribly flame wars as observed the last years on Debian development.
Well, you need to discuss the policy first before implementing it, of course.
And that's the point. No, I think I say first implement it and then document the policy, what's common practice.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think Debian policies should document what is common practice.
Well, the common practice is scattering the things all over the place.
But it is not defined in Debian policy. You won't find the part in Debian policy where it's mandated to scatter all your configuration files in your home directory.
Exactly. That's why I'm thinking of describing a better way of doing it.
And yes, but
then making it required.
I fully agree that it should be documented, but I don't agree that Debian policy is the the perfect place in the first place to do it. I mean, it's very fine to do it as a free desktop spec or as another specification and get applications using it. But I think it's the wrong way to force maintainers to do it out in the blue. Because you will get many upstreams which won't implement it, either because they object or because they are not interested in implementing it.
Well, if the maintainers give them patches, that would significantly would make it significantly easier for upstreams to implement it.
They might not want to.
The maintainers might not want to create patches for it.
Major thing about free software is that people tend to think different and they tend to implement things different. And it's a major that's a good point about free software, because you have the choice between different systems. And forcing to introduce such a major system for the whole system might just not work. And we are getting to a basic problem about free software.
Everything might just not work. And maintainers might just want to change files in other packages along the way. Or might just want to put executable files in the root directory or do something else like that. That's why the policy exists, to set the rules for the packages. That's why...
Yes, but if we really enforce it in Debian policy, we would have to enforce it in every package. And we will, I guess, in at least like 50% of the packages, upstream will not adopt it. So we will diverge from upstream in a lot of cases. And that's probably not what we want.
There is a lot of diversion from the upstream in the file names in the outside the home directory.
Yeah, we already have problems there. Please not introduce them in the user home directory, because.
That's a file system hierarchy standard. It's outside home directory, it's inside home directory, there should be no difference in that. Hmm.
I generally agree that it's a good idea to get this implemented. Yeah. I just disagree about the migration path and the way we implement it.
Well, we have to think if it's really going to work in the first place.
The thing about this ugly hack in the beginning is that all the work of translating from the old file names to new file names is concentrated in one package.
Yes, which is going to have a really large
list of translations, yes. And just by installing that package, you will have a compatible system that implements this specification.
Yes.
And then you can see the benefits.
I think you will never get rid of that ugly hack if you don't want to have like an enormous amount of work to do.
I think that the ugly hack can be do it parallel with the consolidation of the upstreams.
Right.
The upstreams really believes in this, they should be applied by himself, by thyself. So the ugly hack can be made it because there's no conflict with the upstreams, and the upstreams should be convinced that use the 0.6 standard. How is far the 0.6 standard for the 1.0 that you present here? Which is the gap in the middle? 0.6
is much more complicated, actually. It has all the provisions about parsing environmental variables and having multiple configuration directories for one user, with different priorities of files in those configuration directories.
Why a user would use different files with different priorities?
Well, I'm not sure. It sounds like a very interesting idea, but I'm not really seeing the benefits of it. That is why I didn't include this in my proposal. there's a lot of quite complex stuff in the 0.6 version of the specification that actually does require significant changes to the applications. That's why I think it is not made widely accepted.
Because it's complex.
Yes, only a handful of packages programs implement that.
Do the upstream of your package know that it's complex to implement?
For the XCG? Well, they have imported a very small library, and I haven't looked at the next version too close yet.
Because if you change the standards many times, the upstream will say, okay, we're not implementing them.
Yeah.
And he works a lot for, he worked a lot for implementing, he will want to change again.
Okay. The thing is that basically the only difference between, significant difference between this, my proposal and the current regular situation in the applications is the paths where the files are stored. Whether in the 0.6 version of the specs, there's quite a lot of additional code that needs to be added to applications.
And I agree with him, the Debian policy requirement is the step with a long number. It's not step number two. Probably forwarded upstream must be in step one with the RB hack, and the policy requirement will become better. That's not a problem now, I think. Yes.
Well, policy requirement, I'm thinking when through this ugly hacks or other methods, we can get every for every package this translation information that when you install this ugly hack package, you have every configuration file migrated, every user data file migrated to your location. When that is complete, then I think it can be moved to the packages.
I think that the ugly hack could be a good proof of concept of how the standard works, but probably is a really bad solution because it's difficult to maintain. It's probably don't work in every package. So
you have to have different ugly hacks for like C and Python and Chrome, I guess.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, if you put it in glibc, then it would intercept all the file system related calls, just like fake root, for example.
Yes, but maybe some packages make first the change directory and then open one file. Mm-hmm. And this change directory may be relative.
Yeah.
And some
points
not be.
Yeah, that's true.
It's not open the home slash point file slash file also. Normally make cuts and then change directory and open some files and so on.
So it will be useful for proof of concept. So evolution works here, with the loop works like this without the standard, and works like this with the standard, and this is the benefit. But probably will not really use it in reality.
Two minor points here about this LD preload hack. I'm not sure all architectures support LD preloading at all. I remember that MIPS doesn't support it.
Well, it's another problem, so.
And the other thing is, it doesn't work with static binaries.
One of the major targets for the rewrite, proprietary applications would actually be intercepted.
I another point which I don't see addressed in the spec at all. We talked about credentials, confidential information like passwords and these things. I think it would be a very good chance to explicitly mention them and having an interface. This is sensitive information, please make sure that no other application than the application who's supposed to be it can read that. The enforcement of this can be, for example, done by AppArmor or CDNOS or something. But it would help them a lot if the specification would designate them some special kind of this is confidential information.
And would be useful for backup too, because can you have a policy to guard to save the confidential information encrypted or something like this? So will be that's a really good idea.
Yeah.
Manage confidential information
to have the, at least in the specification so that you have a designated storage.
Yeah, that's a really good idea.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good
idea. Mm-hmm. So your special case, because before you said before, you're not sure if that's configuration data at all, because if you remove it, you reset it, then the application isn't usable anymore. That's correct.
Right.
And if you special case it, well, then special case it.
I think so, yeah, it's a really good idea. I think it's necessary.
Let's see.
But the path to email is collaborate with the with the standard, and then the Debian policy can be easy.
Well, making this making a new version of the standard.
Yeah,
that's a little problem because people at the free desktop work are open and have open minds towards this. The major problem is really implementing it in the major software like GNOME, KDE, Mozilla stuff.
If the standard is easy to implement and is stable and is discussed by the community, I think the upstream will be implemented with the time.
It hasn't really happened with the existing standard.
But because it's complex, as you said.
I will. I think I have an example where this ugly hack is going to break horribly. For example, take OpenSSH. Why? At the moment, you have the configuration and confidential data key information in .ssh. Okay. And the default configuration of the OpenSSHD server is looking in .ssh/authorized keys. And if you're now moving, relocating it to /library as an OpenSSH authorized keys,
right,
then you would have to adapt the configuration of the OpenSSHD server.
Yeah, the code that doesn't run as the user.
You see?
Okay, yeah.
And you're going to horribly break the software OpenSSH when you're doing this this library, this encryptor pack. So
right,
you really have to do this in the source. And I'm very interested to see how you convince OpenSSH upstream to adopt this specification. I'm serious.
Yeah, that's true.
We'll be back here.
Try to convince OpenBSD developers to
kind of deal.
I'm thinking as one way of convincing people, hacking the convention of the people is to actually adding this somehow to the file system hierarchy standard.
I think you shouldn't go the way up by making it mandatory by policy requirements. No, I think you should go from the way from down in saying, look, these are my problems, I want to solve, I want to make better backup applications, I want to ensure that security frameworks can more easily define access. For example, I don't see any reason why any application besides my SSH agent should touch my SSH key or my GPG key as well. I don't see any reason why any other application than my GPG agent should be able to read my GPG key. And if this specification, if you can show that this specification is considerably helping security frameworks to enforce sensible security policies. Okay. I think that's way more likely that more upstreams are going to adopt the specifications. So you have to show that there are actual benefits from that.
Yeah, that's a very nice benefit there. Whatever right. Talking point as well. It's both a real benefit and a talking point.
Right. For that. And that's why I'm saying I'm not sure about the migration part. First show that there are actual benefits implemented for major applications like GNOME and OpenSSH.
That's true.
And maybe give it to GNOME because most of my upstreams use files in configuration files in home directories, and probably they even know about the standards, so make a little publicity or give it to GNOME. And step up the path?
I'm not sure that actually many people know about the standard. It has been developed quite quietly and put up on the free desktop org site and forgotten about for a few years.
But a huge call of comments will be that many developers can help you.
Right.
And they will be feel that they are part of that, mm-hmm. So they will be agree with the standard too. Mm.
The Debian policy requirement I'm seeing actually as the final push towards making a complete support. So
yes, but you can't do it before it's already widely adopted.
Yeah,
well, you can, but you probably don't want to.
No, you can't, because the Debian policy editors will treat you with a large stick if you try.
If you implement in the policy and it's not widely adopted, there will be a huge amount of release critical bugs with PRC violation. Yes. And there are no will be solved never.
I think we all agree that migration is not really easy.
Yes.
So it will
migration.
Take a lot of
yeah.
time and will mm-hmm. take a lot of effort.
It's
yeah,
like there was
the
USH doc to USH RAM doc migration.
Mm-hmm. And really, probably
it was not really adopted at the time of creation of the policy.
And probably well it took years.
Exactly. I don't think this is going to end in this decade.
No, you have to show that there are benefits.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
And if you really want to enforce it, we would have to put it in policy probably. Maybe not as a requirement, but as a really, really should.
Well, first it needs to be introduced as should.
Yeah, and then
and
we need
like
tons of mass backfiling and stuff like that. And
that's true.
Well, it's going to take a lot of time. We
can
maybe
we
should think about how we
talk for a few seconds.
Yeah.
Okay, sure. I think you should be ending. I don't know.
If you want to do it like in one release, that release is going to take like 5-6 years, and it's probably not what we want. And if you want to do it like in between a couple of releases, that's going to be probably even harder.
It's going to take several years anyway. I think it's going to go in like it would be a should for one release, at least, and then it could be converted to a requirement for the next release. If it goes
well. Thanks for the talk.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah.